Welcome to Pleasant Green Sunday School. This is Lesson 10 for August the 6th, 2017. We begin a new unit today, Unit 3, entitled Calls in the New Testament. And our topic for today, taken from the Adult Quarterly, is Meeting Needs. Meeting Needs. Our devotional reading comes out of the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 14 through 28. Our background scripture comes out of Acts chapter 1 and then chapters 6 and 7. And we'll be studying today from Acts chapter 6 verses 1 through 8. Our key verse reads, "Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business." That's taken from Acts chapter 6 verse 3 from the King James Version. Our lesson aims today, number one, is to explain the ministry challenges of evangelism and benevolence in the first century church in Jerusalem. Secondly, to sense the ministry challenges of evangelism and benevolence in the 21st century church. And then thirdly, to establish ministry priorities and act to meet them. We have three outlines today that we will be discussing from our Adult Quarterly. The first outline is entitled The Complaint. The second outline is entitled Stephen and the Others Chosen. And then our third outline is entitled The Church Grows. It is a great privilege and an honor to be able to share this lesson with you today, to come back to our Sunday school lesson. I really enjoy studying and reading and sharing the Word of God with you. We hope that you have been following us. We completed a very comprehensive look at the prophets from our last unit, and today we're going to talk about meeting needs, and we are in the book of Acts today. From the sixth chapter, verses 1 through 8. I want to read a little bit of the biblical context from this lesson quarterly, and then we may read a little bit from our lesson standard. But in today's lesson, we see how the early church experienced its first growing pains. That should not be a surprise. The surprise is that it had not happened sooner. After all, at the beginning of Acts chapter 6, the early church had, by some estimates, well more than 20,000 members. We need to keep in mind that these were people from all walks of life and different culture upbringings. We see the first major problem involved the distribution of benevolence to the Grecian Jewish Christian widows. The cultural bias by the Hebrew Jewish Christians toward the Grecian Jewish Christians was made worse by the more reserved nature of the Grecian Jewish widows. They were not as forthcoming about concerns, so we can imagine how their feelings of being slighted finally reached the breaking point. So it is easy to understand, this is coming from our lesson standard, the nature of this conflict between the Grecians and the Hebrews, all share of Jewish background, but the distinction is some identify themselves secondarily with the Greek language and culture that predominates outside the borders of Israel, while others identify more with the Hebrew language and culture that predominates within Israel proper. And so there is so much background for this lesson. We won't be able to touch on all of it, but we hope that you will do your own homework and take a look at the historical account of the problems with the early church. And it should be noted that I guess the overarching theme of this lesson, we want to keep in mind there are problems in every church. There are problems in every church, but there are two things that I want you to pay close attention to as we study this lesson. Obviously, we're going to deal with the complaint that comes out of Acts chapter 6, verses 1 through 4, but I want to make mention of there is a solution to our problems that we have in the church. And so these widows here were being neglected, the Hellenist, Greek-speaking Jews. So I want to start with Acts chapter 6, verses 1 through 4, and we'll talk a little bit more about this culture issue in the church. Both of these groups that are opposed to one another are both Jews, as we said earlier, but one native-born Hebrew or Israelites, and then the other Grecian-speaking Jews were not getting along in the early church. Acts chapter 6, verses 1 through 4, the Bible says, "And in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied, there arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration." Verse 2, "Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, It is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you, 7 men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word." I want to make a couple of points about this serving tables, to wait tables during this time in this culture. It included financial and temporal duties. So the Grecian Jews were Hellenists who adopted the Greek language and customs, but the Hebrews clung to Aramaic and Jewish practices. So you could see the issue here. But the Old Testament required, talking about these widows, required care of the poor and needy. You can see some reference in Psalm 9, verse 18. This concern is seen in the social action set forth. I want you to look at Acts chapter 2, verse 44 and 45, and then Acts chapter 4, verses 34 through 37. But here the age-old problem of discrimination had emerged. The widows of Grecian Jews were considered outsiders by native-born Jews who were not getting their share of the food distribution, probably deriving in part from the generous giving. That's back over in Acts chapter 4, verses 34 through 37. So, since it was customary for the men to speak on behalf of women in that day's culture, it is a certainty that the reference to those complaining in verse 1 were men. The Greek word used to describe these complaints inferred that these complaints began as intense murmuring among the Grecian widows. So what was their complaint? It was simple. The Grecian widows thought that they were being overlooked in the daily food distribution. Now, we should not think negatively about these widows. Rather, we have to understand that women had few, if any, rights when it came to property or household possession. So when a woman became a widow, she was literally helpless. So because of this cultural custom, we can see exhortations for believers to aid widows. I want you to look at Deuteronomy chapter 24, verses 19 through 21, and also Job chapter 31, verses 16 through 23, and then Isaiah chapter 1, verse 17. So we should not believe that the church leader's oversight was deliberate. It was more of a case of poor administration and supervision. And so we should also consider the work of Satan in this matter. He had previously tried to act or to attack the early church externally. But in Acts chapter 6, we see his first attempts in disrupting the church from within. His goal was simple, to divide and conquer. Satan continued to meddle and had the potential to divide the early church. So the 12 disciples, and we have to remember that Matthias replaced Judas Iscariot. So they convened a church meeting and decided what they should do and how they should confront this matter. But it's interesting, as I said earlier, sometimes we think that there are no problems in the church. But as we get a little bit further in this lesson, we're going to see that the 12, they did the best they could in how to juggle their ministry of spreading the word of God and handling the distribution for the widow. So they offered a solution. So they asked the church to choose 7 men from among the church to administer and supervise the daily distribution. But there are these requirements here that the disciples employed here to selecting the seventh. I want to lift here. The 12 specified 3 requirements in verse 3. First, the candidates of this distribution, this office, this administration, or deacons, if you will, they had to have the trust of the church community, or in other words, they had to be known. And then second, they had to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Being filled meant that these men lived upright lives under the direction and control of the Holy Spirit. So when we talk about someone in Stephen's case, being full of the Holy Ghost, and we see that term used, it should be understood that we are looking at someone who was controlled by the Holy Spirit, who obeyed, who followed the leading and the prompting of the Holy Spirit. And so it goes on to say that finally they had to have wisdom and common sense. These prerequisites are necessary to handle the logistics of the food distribution of the early church. So with the 7 at work, the 12 could keep their 100% devotion to prayer and daily sharing of the gospel message. You know, every culture, every church structure is somewhat different. We're going to give you some scriptures a little bit later on to talk about what Paul did with Timothy in terms of getting some help and support in the church during his time. But we know that we have pastors and elders and reverends and so on, and bishops, and then we have deacons. And so these other administrative duties of the church, they undergird, they support the administration of the church, and it gives the pastor or our church leaders some liberty to stay and keep their focus on the word of God and not getting caught up in some of these other matters. Not that they are not important, but you could appreciate the fact that even during this time, the disciples, the apostles here, wanted to keep their concern, the 12, on prayer. That's very important. They wanted to stay fervent in prayer, and they wanted to make sure that they were focusing in on what God wanted them to do in terms of getting that message out. So if I could just shorten this a little bit, what I'm saying is that all of our leaders, our pastors and so on, they need help in ministry, and it takes a great burden off of the pastor when he doesn't have to subject himself to every menial task or every duty in the church. And so that is the concern here. So and as I said earlier, it's not that we won't have problems, but what I loved about this lesson in looking at the remedy, the first mention here, in other words, the individuals had to be well known in the, or respected in the church community, but also they had to be filled with the Holy Ghost. I wish we could, you know, if I had some time to labor with that, if we would use some of the things that the early church used, because if we have a problem, then the Holy Ghost, our paraclete, our helper, that Jesus said will never leave us and never forsake us, he has an answer, and we can always rely on the Holy Spirit. And not only that, it meant that these men were not just filled with the Holy Spirit, but that they were under control by the same Spirit. That's very important. People who are out of control, who are more prone to doing things in and of themselves without leaning and depending on the Holy Spirit, we know that that is not a plan that is going to work. But this issue here, we saw and we read about Satan being involved in disrupting the unity. As we read in the outline here, some of the biblical context from this quarterly, well over 20,000 people. And not only that, we don't get back over in the fourth chapter of the book of Acts, we see this community, the church community, having all things in common, or they are working together. But just know that's a prime a state for the enemy to begin to try to infiltrate the church community, is when we are together, or when we are working in unity. So we understand that where there's unity, there's strength. So not only did these individuals have the numbers to support the church community, but they also had the unity. And so now Satan has come in and has infiltrated between the Jews, the Grecian-speaking, Greek-speaking Jews, and the native-born Jews about this food. And so a decision had to be made. And so the question is asked in the quarterly here, considering your pastor in today's lesson, what are some ways that you can help your pastor handle the many administrative tasks of the church? And, you know, immediately the Spirit of the Lord reminded me of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I hope that you will read that, because all of us have, as believers, born-again believers in the church, we have a function. You are not, and you shouldn't be just a wanderer in ministry. You shouldn't be just a person without a function. And you shouldn't be a person without understanding that you have been uniquely fitted together, joined together with God through Jesus Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit to perform a function. And so when you get over in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, you will see a diversity of gifts. And that is the problem that we see, ironically, in the church. It's that diversity clash. It's that culture clash. And so we should understand that the body of Christ is universal. It's not so dependent on one local church, but we are all members of the body of Christ, and with that we have various functions. And so what I'm saying is that we need one another, and we should support our pastors and our leaders in whatever capacity that we have been gifted to perform that task. That gift that you were given by the Holy Spirit is for the edification of the entire body. So we have to keep that in mind, that God didn't give you a gift just for you. He gave you a gift that it would be a blessing and a benefit to the entire body, not just your local church, but to the body of Christ. at large. So, but I thought that was beautiful in talking about the administrative task. There are many functions that we have to contend with. And so can you imagine 20 early church and there is a issue of food, a distribution of food, and the groups are bickering and murmuring, complaining back and forth. So we have to be careful that we keep our love and our unity strong amongst the believers. That is our core. That is how we are fitted together. It was in love, and we have to keep that. And so these complaints have a tendency to divide us, and then this is how we start developing cliques. But as we see these two groups, both of them are Jews, but they are not getting along with one another. So here in our second outline, Stephen and the others chosen. This is taken from Acts chapter 6, verses 5 and 6. And again, I want to read this from the King James Version. Verse 5, and the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost, and Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch, verse 6, whom they set before the apostles, and when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them. So here, just wanted to make mention of this word proselyte. It is a non-Jew, is someone who has accepted the Jewish faith and completed the rituals to become Jews. You can see some reference back over in Matthew chapter 23, verse 15. But I was looking a little bit more into how decisions were made. You may have heard the term the Urim and the Thummim. These articles, if you will, your reference will take you back over into Exodus chapter 28. All of that is good, but particularly verses 15 through 30. But what the priest was tasked with back over in Exodus chapter 28, he had the breastplate of judgment. The breastplate of judgment. It was the priest's job and to have these articles. History doesn't tell us how these articles, these objects were used that were that the priests were carrying, but the idea was they needed to determine what the will of God was. And so the choosing of these seven suggests that they had to determine these seven individuals were the ones that were chosen. And so being filled with the Holy Ghost, we are always prompted what to do and how to do. And so I just want to make mention of that, that you can see this custom of trying to determine how they selected these sevens. Verse 6 in Acts chapter 6 says, whom they set before the apostles. Once they selected these individual men, and then they prayed, you see. So and then they laid their hands on them. But the question is, how did they know that these were the individuals? And so now we get into this discussion of the breastplate of judgment and trying to determine the will of God. And I just want to make mention of that as we study this lesson. It's very important that the functions that we perform in the church be according to the will of God. That is so huge. If it's not according to the will of God, then you should understand that that will not work. So we have to do things the old saints would say, according to the dictation of the Holy Spirit. So these men, these apostles, had been praying. The text doesn't tell us how long they had been praying or which one of them received the inclination the unctioning of the Holy Spirit as to who and to how and to if these gentlemen, these men, were the ones who would take over this function. Keep in mind, these are individuals who are going to be incorporated in ministry. Rather, they're in charge of the distribution of the food in this case, or some other task in the church. We need to make sure that we talk to God about the individuals that we bring into the ministry assignments of the church. Because if we don't, then we all know, and we have heard of stories where individuals that we have selected of ourselves without God's unctioning us, or the Holy Spirit unctioning us, have wreaked havoc in our churches. And they brought the same thing that Satan brought. They brought disruption. So we want to keep that in mind. But there is a focus here on the specifics who were chosen. The first glance of the names of the seven reveals that each had a Grecian name. So since the issue had been with Grecians, Grecian leaders would be able to better understand the specific needs and quickly gain acceptance in the Grecian community. I'm not going to read all of this, but I want you to understand that when we have problems in the church, let me say this again, there is a solution. And we have to do what these apostles did in this day during this issue. They prayed. They came together. And I like this back over in this second outline. The decision, it was acceptable by the whole community. That's very important that we agree on the decisions that are made for our churches to go forward, because again, there so many times our decision disrupts the body of Christ, and it disrupts our local church. So I want you to keep those things in mind. But we have another question here in the quarterly. How does the office of deacon in your congregation compare and contrast with that of the role of the seven? And so we promise to give you 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 8 through 13. Paul was giving Timothy some directives for church and for church order. And so he gave him some directives on how to choose, how to select, what men should be considered in terms of fulfilling these roles. And we have to do that. We really have to talk to God about these individuals and concerning these individuals, and do more investigative probing into the direction that a lot of these ministries and leaders are intending to take the church. And so we already have a disruption in the faith community, but it has to be resolved. But our last outline is entitled "The Church Grows." This is the results. We had a complaint in the first outline, and we've progressed through this lesson, and we've read on how the apostles addressed it. And so now we get back to the business at hand. There was at least twice mentioned throughout this lesson, even in our lesson aims, about evangelism. I wish I had a little time to deal with that, because that's the reason why that the disciples wanted to stay focused on their evangelistic efforts and sowing the seeds that God had given them to sow, that men might be saved. But here, the church grows. This is Acts chapter 6, verse 7 and 8. And the Bible says, again from the King James Version, "And the word of God increased." You see that? That was the focus that the apostles had, was to make sure that the gospel increased. The word of God, they kept preaching. They didn't let the trials stop them. They didn't let the tribulation stop them. They didn't let the complaint stop them. They got somebody, seven guys to handle that, and they got back to the task of sowing the word of God. It increased. So that means they kept doing what they were supposed to do. And look at this, and the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly. I want you to understand again about those requirements of these individuals. When you do what God tells you to do, God will bring about the increase. This is not so much the work of the apostles. And if you remember back over in Matthew 28, when Jesus was giving his disciples directives in the Great Commission, he tells them, he said, "Lo, I will be with you." He did not send them alone. He went with them. And so what we have to understand here is that the apostles are doing what the Holy Spirit is unctioning them to do through the commandments of Jesus Christ, which came from God himself. And God is bringing about an increase in the church, in the faith community. And a great company of priests were obedient to the faith. That's what we said earlier. We have to obey. It's all right to have faith. That's good. But we have to comply. We have to obey what we believe. We have to obey the word of God. If you believe the word of God, then the requirement is that you obey. And these priests were not just getting in the multitude. They were obeying. And then verse 8 says, "And Stephen, full of faith, controlled by what he believed and the Holy Ghost, did great wonders and miracles among the people." If we want God to work, if we really want God to show up in our midst, if we want God to come into what we're doing and be a part of that, don't you know we're going to have to obey him? Wheresoever two or three of my believers come together in my name, God says he will be in the midst. But how do we come together? Do we just join together? Do we just get in the same building? Or is there something more that needs to go on after we have assembled, or when we assemble? Do we need to be in love with one another? Do we need to be in unity with one another? Does it matter if we all believe the same thing? All of these things we have to deal with and understand that they are a part of the miracle process. They are a part of what God wants to do in our midst, is to show up in our midst. And to God never wanted to be outside of his people. He wanted to be in the fellowship, in the worship, in the community, dwelling with them. And so this is powerful here in terms of what our expectations are when we come together as saints of God. Something ought to happen. Something should happen. Something miraculous can and should take place when believers come together in the body of Christ. When we come together in the Word of God, when we come together in prayer, things ought to happen among us. Keep those things in mind. So, what were the immediate results of the resolution of the conflict in the early church? The church kept on growing. I circled this and highlighted it in my Sunday school book here, because I think we forget sometimes that when all of the dust settles, the question should be, are we growing? Is our church growing? Not just in numbers. Are we growing in faith? Are we growing in unity? Are we growing in love? There are many ways to gauge your growth, but somebody has to take a look at it and determine if there is growth or not. If we all have all of this faith that we say we have, there should be some growth. But the original Greek sentence structure in verse 7 suggests that this was a rapid continuation of growth already achieved. Still, the growth was limited. The number of the disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly. Satan sought to divide the church. However, God, through the power of His Holy Spirit, greatly multiplied the church. Let me just say this. Now that we understand that there's problems, there will be problems in the church, we need to focus on how we're going to address these things. What obviously practical application are we going to use to solve the problem? But what spiritual application are we going to use? Are we going to just talk about one another? Are we going to stop talking about one another? We're going to start praying for and with one another. Something has to change. And so when we see how God got in the midst, God is ultimately in control. God is ultimately the one who vindicates, who justifies, who raises us, who blesses us, who keeps us, who anoints us. God is God all by Himself. And so what God did was, and you'll see this theme throughout the book of Acts, particularly in the few chapters of early on in the book, that God added to their number. God added. God added. The apostles didn't add. God added. God brought more. God added more. God multiplied more. So we understand this better now. So, but we can see here, this rapid growth suggested that the Grecians did not have, watch this, did not have any lingering animosity. So I want to make mention here, I just want you to understand that God had to work on the individuals as well as the situation. Let me say that again. God had to work on the individuals as well as the situation, the dispute, the problem, the issue. We need, sometimes when we have problems and we're looking at it and we say, well, I think I know what it is. Maybe the problem is you. Maybe the problem is what you think. Maybe the problem is how you feel. Maybe the problem is what you want to do versus what God wants to do. So what God did, and I know that He did it here, because this is a heart matter between these native-born Jews and the Grecians, Jews. They had no lingering animosity. We know the adage, forgive, but don't forget. In the church, God wants us to reconcile in agape love. How powerful was their witness? So, despite having been steeped in the law and the traditions of the Jewish religious leaders, many Jewish priests became disciples. Let's talk about the one aspect of evangelism. When people see that we know how to conduct ourselves, and we know how to treat one another as Christians, don't you know that's magnetic? That's attractive. When the world sees the peace that you have, don't you know they want that? Don't you know they want to be a part? Don't you know they want to ask you a question about how you have such peace and how you have such joy? So I want you to understand here that part of evangelism is not just what we say, it's what we do. It's what we think. It's how we act. This is what the world is looking at us for. We are saying something, but we're doing something else. So as others looked on, God even added priests to the fold. God added obedient people. And we need that today. We need to pray that God will add obedient disciples to the faith. We don't just want disciples. We don't just want to fill up a room with people who won't comply with the word of God. What good is that? We need people who are willing, as Isaiah says in the first chapter to Israel, if you be willing and obey, you will eat the good of the land. So I'm just thankful that we saw a complaint. The Holy Spirit moved on his apostles. They rendered a solution. It was accepted. And the results. One of the things that's not mentioned here is how long that took. That's something we need to consider. Some of these things are not immediate that can be resolved. But if we keep praying, some things in your life and my life have not as yet been resolved. But we don't stop praying. We keep praying. And we keep trusting in the Lord to bring about the manifestation. But I hope, trust, and pray. But I do want to, just before we go, I want to read deal with this last question here in the quarterly. Considering the ministries of your congregation, how many are focused on evangelism and how many are focused on benevolence? Are your congregation's ministries balanced? That's something for another time, and that we can talk about that. But we need to make sure that we are part of the growth process. Every one of you listening to my voice today, ask yourself this question. Do I just go to church, or am I the church? Do I just attend, or am I a part of? And I challenge you to become a part of the evangelistic movement of your church. If you don't have an evangelistic movement, maybe you should write a program and institute it. Ask God to help you and move you to flank yourself with people who are like-minded, that we may get about our Father's business. The Great Commission was given to every believer. It's not a group, it's a church mandate. So we hope, trust, and pray that we have given you something to think about today. And I want to read this closing prayer. All-knowing God, we thank you for giving us an opportunity to serve in our congregations. We ask you, dear Lord, to fill us with the Holy Spirit, wisdom, and faith, so that we can be effective in our work. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. So again, until such time that the Lord will permit us to come together again, we say God bless you.